Hello, welcome to Tight Lines. There are many famous sportsmen who are keen anglers. Most of the Sky Sports cricket commentary team for a start, along with loads of footballers, David Seaman, Gazza and Jimmy Bullard as examples. However, not many of them have made angling their second career. After many years as one of the world's top athletes, Dean Macey, my very special guest this week, has done more or less just that. I'm really pleased to have him here in the body, and we'll have some fun and learn a bit about fishing too. Also coming up on today's show, you can see Dean and myself out together on the banks of the River Kennet in Berkshire, where we endured a very tough session in the search for a specimen chub. We visit Bristol's Chew Valley Lake with fly angler and pike fishing fanatic John Horsey as he gets afloat in the hunt for one of the iconic venue's mightiest predators. And there'll be great advice for all types of anglers in fishery focus as I look at the sport being found and the best approaches to take at a selection of UK waters. Well, Dino, I think the last time you were here in the body, you were actually sat in this chair.
Slightly more stressed than I am now, I've got to say as well, yeah. I didn't have quite as funky jumper on as
you've
got there. I absolutely love it, mate. I'm so jealous I dressed down.
Oh, it's very nice, your one. Oh, very plain, but it's very nice.
Wow.
You're having a great angling career, mate, and I know this year you've had a particularly spectacular year and you've enjoyed yourself.
Do you know what? Funny you say that, because I looked back a couple of weeks ago and I thought to myself, oh, do you know what? I haven't caught this and I haven't caught that and I haven't caught this. And then I looked through my albums and actually, like you said, I've ticked a lot of boxes this year. And, you know, one thing I have done is a lot of features and a lot of filming. And and last winter, I hit it hard all last winter, whether it was icy, flooded, whatever. I just went out and hoped that if there was a bite to be had, then I would be the one to have it. And it sort of played... It sort of got a little bit hard in the end. So this December, being my birthday and Christmas, I said to the missus, right, OK, this is sort of like my month off. If it's perfect, I'm off, I'm going fishing. If it's not, I'm staying indoors and I'm going to be a good house husband.
Well, I'm glad today you're being a good bothy man, because we'd rather have you here than on the bank today, in particular today. Now, Dean, like me, loves his chub fishing. He probably doesn't recall the bad old days when any attempts I had at chasing chevron involved dry nets and very long faces. A couple of weeks ago, his eternal optimism led us both to the banks of the River Kennet, not far from Reading. Would it be chub Valhalla or the more usual vexation? Years ago when I first met you, we were fishing at Rochford Angling Club. We went down to do some fishing and the producer at the time had me running and jumping.
I remember.
Backwards and forwards to make it look good. Do you remember that?
I remember the opener, yeah. I remember feeling the shakes, because you weren't quite as slim back then. I mean, you look like an athlete now.
Yeah,
I remember
right.
Feeling the rattles. I thought it was thunder from the opener. But yeah, mate, I remember you giving us an absolute whipping on the day. But I learned so many things, as I always do when I'm out with quality anglers, like yourself.
Oh, here we
but
go.
But hopefully...
But since then, how many times we said we'll go fishing again together, and 15 years later, just 15 years later...
It's quality, mate, not quantity. Yeah. And I brought you to a lovely stretch of the River Kennet at Burfield, and in my mind, not a better big chub stretch of the Kennet there is, to be honest with you. I mean, I've had some phenomenal catches. It looks a bit low today, but, you know, it's overcast this morning. We've had a little bit of rain. Looks pucker. We're on the maggot and the float. There's no better way to waste the day, really, is there?
Go and catch them.
Come on.
And what you've said is to start shallow.
What I like to do, let's say, for instance, we've got four and a half, 5 foot in this week, as a guess, because last time I fished it was 2 foot higher. You know, when you're fishing or when you're feeding them for half an hour, 45 minutes, quite often they'll come up to the feed and intercept it. So the way I see it is that if you fish 2 foot deep at the start, it's easy to put 6 inches on and you don't spook them.
Don't want to go past them.
Exactly. So you go 4 foot straight away and they're in 2 foot deep. You could get a liner and just spook them straight away. Definitely going. Well, you get addicted by watching other people's slopes, don't you? Right, I'm off. See you in a bit.
well, I call it the stump, but a lot of people call it the aquarium, but whatever they call it, this is the last of pretty much the most popular swims, and it does normally contain a few fish. And actually, you know, above and beyond the bankers that I would call that we've had a go in so far today that I haven't produced, this one probably looks, in these conditions, the better bet. But it's a little bit more pace on this one to the other one, wasn't it? The last one was a fantastic chub swim, looked brilliant for the feeder.
Yeah.
Which I have brought my feeder rod and a few black caps just in case, but let's face it, sitting behind the tip is exciting for us, but boring for you guys. So we're going to try and persevere and get them on the float until 2 hours to go, and then it's...
Every man for himself.
Exactly. I love this style of fishing, though. Especially when there's two of you, because there's something to do. I know I look lazy at the moment, but one fishes, one feeds.
Yeah.
Then the other, then you reverse, and it's a nice way of doing it. And I'll also say this, generally this time of year, pushing into December, it is cold, but we ain't got, like, freezing conditions.
No.
If you get a bite in the swim, on the maggot, there's a good chance you're going to get a couple.
Yeah.
Push has come to shove, and I think between us we've decided that the river has just not got anywhere near the flow that you need for a decent day's float fishing on it. The float is trundling through at like 0.05 mile an hour. It's almost no speed on it whatsoever. So I've just got the bait dropper rod out and my feeder rod. I'm just going to put a little bit of bait in a couple of likely looking swims, and then we're going to sit it out on the feeder. I know I said it was going to be a bit boring, but fact of the matter is we want to try and catch. And stick a maggot feeder over the top. Tiny little short hook link, start off about 7 inches, and if we get a few feeder knocks, shorten it right down to sort of 3 or 4 inches, because if the chub do start having it, quite often they actually attack the feeder and attack the maggots and try and shove them out of the holes. So one more bait dropper in here, and now I'm going to go look for a couple more little areas, and fingers crossed, I'd like to say we're on plan B. We're probably a long way further down the alphabet than that, but we'll see.
We've got about an hour of light left. The sun's come out now. It's a lovely afternoon. It's not cold, but the clarity of the water and the lack of flow has just made it very difficult. But as the sun goes down, Dino thinks we've got a really good chance. He said there were fish in this swim at the weekend. Fish were seen in this swim. Somebody caught one from the swim upstream. And just keep at it, maybe into dark, and we might just get one. But it really is hard work.
Well, it's my second swim on the feeder. This is the one that I actually, while I was fishing the other swim, I came down here and put 5 droppers of maggot in just to give me almost a head start. But I've probably had my feeder in about 10 minutes now. Not so much as a sign. The maggots are coming back almost fresher than they went in. So I think that's a good sign. The water temperature's reasonable. It's not warm, but it's reasonable. But there's no small fish having it. There's absolutely no signs of fish. Bad news is that we've got a little bit of sun coming. And this particular time of year, or any time of year, to be honest with you, during the day, sun is the kiss of death. The good news is that if we are going to get a bite during the day, then maggot's the one to do it for you. The other bit of good news is that we've got dusk. And dusk, any time of year, for any species, is by far the best time to get a bite. So we've still got a few trump cards. Keith's on the float still, I believe. And I'm sitting it out on the feeder, so... Fingers crossed. It might be one of them days.
Well, I think that's about it. We were here before dawn this morning. It's now dusk. And we've certainly given it our best shot, and the fish just haven't played ball. It can happen so easy this time of year. You've got a clear river. It's lacking in flow. Everything you don't want it to be. And it's a shame, because there's some magnificent fish here. But listen, it's the first time I've been fishing with Dino for 15 years. We're going to do it again a lot sooner than that. We will, mate, as well, won't we? I mean, it was a shame, but you could see everything that was wrong with winter fishing, not just chub fishing. You know, you feel if you maybe put a bit of punch bread on, you might have got a little roach, because they won't take anything but bread when it's... But it was just...
Do you know, once we didn't catch in the first hour and a half, in two of the most productive swims that I've ever fished down there, with the overcast weather and then the sun started coming out, I started thinking... Oh boy, we're in trouble. And you know, you was absolutely right. There was a couple of fish caught the weekend before, but all on heave it and leave it methods, all on boilies, and you know, well after dark as well, which ain't great for filming. But what did I say at the end of the shoot in the car park? I said, you know what? Between now and when we get in the studio, I'm going to go and catch myself a nice big chub so I can show you a picture. And you said, I'll do the same. Where's yours?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, well, I haven't been since. I'll show you some pictures of other species, but that's. That's one, very recent one.
Yeah, that was from the River Lee, and exactly the same problems on the Lee at that particular time. It was only a few days after that Kennet trip, actually, as what there was on the Kennet. Yeah. No water, very clear, not a lot of flow, and basically I just heaved out a boilie, slightly sort of tweaked my barbel rigs ever so slightly, and we'll talk about that a little bit later, I'm sure.
Yeah, we'll have a look at them a bit later, because, you know, it's time for a mince pie. Welcome back to Tight Lines. Predators are a key target for specialist anglers over the colder months, and if it's pike you're after, then few venues in this country can match the aura of Chew Valley Lake near Bristol, a water that's produced some huge fish in recent years. Now, John Horsey may be better known as a fly angler, but the Chew local loves his pike sport, and last month we joined him on a session with fishery manager Tony Donnelly.
Here I am at my office, ready to go fishing for the day. This lake is renowned for a fantastic trout fishery, but also everybody knows it now as the mecca for pike angling in the UK. Morning, Tony.
Morning, John. Good to see you.
Yeah, good to see you as well. What a great day.
Yeah, lovely day. Should stay dry. Wind's meant to pick up a little bit later, though. Meant to be from the west or northwest.
OK, what should we do? Should we, as it's soft, should we go across the other side, fish that for a while, and when the wind picks up, come back here and deep water?
Yeah, let's get over to Morton or Stratford first and give it a go whilst we can, and if we have to move back later, we can do that.
Perfect plan. Right. Numbers of fish in these trials this year?
It's been excellent so far. This autumn's gone really well. We've had 20 fish over 30 pounds and two over 40, including our new lake record of 43 pounds.
Wow.
Which is fantastic. Very pleased.
Right, let's go out and catch a 44 pounder. Okay. Let's go get him.
Sounds like a challenge. Let's do it.
It is. Fish on.
Don't think
it's a trout. It's always that thing. Let's see how big it is. Oh, it's a nice fish. It's a double at least. I think these pike are fighting harder this year than I've ever known them, Tony. It's a great fight. I didn't think it was that big a fish, but you never know. Okay, over to you. Oh, it's a good fish.
Yay. Excellent.
Oh, great start. Excellent. Right, let's have a look at this one. Hooks came out okay. Whoa. So ready to go back. There we are. It's a nice Chew double. We can give it a quick weigh in the weigh net. Good start to the day anyway, Tony. 13.5. 13.5 pounds. Quite a short fish, isn't it? Like a lot of Chew fish, quite deep. We don't even have to pick it out, we can just release it from the net. A lot of these baits we buy are all blast frozen. So you get packets of these baits. Herring is a great bait, but I think it helps even more if you take the head off. Chuck that in for a bit of loose feed. And that just lets a bit more of the oils out. And that's what the pike are picking up here. They're actually picking up on the scent trail. So baits like herring have got a lot of scent. Mackerel have. Blueys are fantastic, loads of oil. So you take one of the trebles. There's one with a tiny little bit of a barb on it that goes through the tail and through the backbone that runs through the fish. And then you put the other treble, further up along the shank, along the flank rather, like that. And that holds it in place. And aerodynamically, that's much easier to cast. And you can chuck it out a long way, especially with a 40 gram weight on that I've got on here. As you can see, the wind's picked up and it's changed direction somewhat. So we're going to try and move to the top of the wind so our anchor will actually hold, and our mud anchor, which we put at the back of the boat to stabilise it, will take so that we're not swinging around too much. Otherwise, it keeps pulling the baits off the station, and sometimes the wind gets that strong that it pulls the anchor off the bottom as well and we move. So we're trying to find an area that's a bit softer but still holds fish. Get it back out there. Definite run on here. I think I'm going to have to hit it in a minute. Let's just see if it moves off. Yes, it's turning.
Oh, yeah, it's starting to move.
So I'm going to hit this fairly early. Yep. OK, fish on, but first of all, what species? And secondly, how big? The way it's coming to the surface, I wouldn't say it's big. And it just head-banged then, so it could even be the wrong species for us today. It's come out of nearly 30 feet of water, so it might be... No, it's pike. Good pike, Tony. I could do with a... wee bit of help. That's a good fish. Whoa. That's just what we want. Nice. Right, it's coming up towards the surface again. It's a nice fish. Okay, what we don't want it to do is, okay. This time, Tone?
Yep.
Brilliant.
Lovely, well done.
Thank you, mate. That's a, nice a good fish. That's a good... Yeah. Probably a mid-double again?
Yeah, mid-double.
Well, that didn't take long.
Clean fish, bright fish.
Beautiful. Right. Let's try and get rid of things like the weights. I prefer to keep them in the landing net as much as possible rather than take them out into the boat and stress them. I do see that happen quite a bit. So I far prefer to try and do the unhooking in the water if I can. I don't care if people call me a wimp because I've got a glove on. You learn your lessons sometimes. There we are, just one of the prongs of the treble is in there. The other one's in the net. Look at that for a set of teeth. Incredible. Okay, we've unhooked our fish. There she is. 15 and a half pounds of Chew Valley Esox Lucius. Lovely fish. Shortish fish, but deep, full of fry by the feel of it. But we put it back pretty quickly now. No damage done. Let's put this one back carefully. These fish always swim straight back down to the bottom again. Wherever you catch them, they always go straight back down. This one's kicking. Look at that. Thanks very much. Yes? The end time? Yep. You are, definitely.
It's not big, I don't think. It's not a big fish, but it's
getting
a good account of itself. Here. It's a trout. There we go.
Not a trout.
Big rainbow.
Wow. That's a huge one. Look at the size of that. What a cracking trout, Tony. What did it take?
Herring. It's a bit of a surprise at the end of the day there for us, but yeah, it's a welcome fish. He's only lightly hooked, so there's no problems there, so we'll just pop him straight back. It'll be fine.
How big do you think it is?
I'd say 6.5.
Fantastic fish. Well, we've had a couple of great pike, yep. Had a couple of trout. We've had a great day.
Yeah, can't
thanks,
knock it.
Mate.
Excellent. Brilliant.
Brilliant. Brilliant. Thank you very much. Well done.
And I was there with John, all those rainbows that take with little tiny buzzers. That one's took a big... Do you hit the piking? Do you like piking?
I have. I've done a lot of it over the years. Not so much for the last 6 or 7 winters, but I went out quite a bit with my old mate, Nigel Williams. And,
oh, yeah.
And I sort of upped my PB, you know, to the point where it's 19.15. Ooh. So it's a very recent
honest
target
man.
For me, if you like. In the next couple of winters, I'll be doing a fair bit. I just want 2 ounces. Yeah. That's all I want. £20 once, it's a lot better than 19.15 for me. But I love the species. I think they're magnificent.
And would you go to one of the venues like Chew, where you're likely to get a reel out size fish, or you're happy like hunting your local rivers?
Do you know what? I don't mind. I mean, I just love fishing. I mean, several times you call me a specimen angler. I just go fishing for different species. I just like to think there's something special out there. So, no, I mean, like I said, I haven't targeted them for probably 5 or 6 winters, so I'd start at the bottom again and then work my way up. I wouldn't go straight for the big ones.
Well, we'll stop calling you specialist and we'll start calling you special.
Spodger.
Dean Macey's. Now, as ever, we ask our guests to choose their choice of fishery, and Dean's gone for a day ticket. Like, you've gone for Churchwood.
Yeah, I have, purely because, I mean, like you said, with the low pressure coming in and reasonably mild going into Christmas as well, a little bit of winter carp fishing, it baffles me when we get half-decent conditions. And I've caught them on this particular venue down to -2 degrees.
Goodness me.
Steve, the owner, keeps the aerators on both lakes, Churchwood and Jenkins, all year round. So, you know, you've never got a solid lid on top of it. And he keeps a bit of bait a couple of times a week trickling in. And always spots where there's, you know, where there's localised sort of little pods of fish, if you like. They're not big venues, and it's just good to go and have a nice winter bite. There's fish to over £30 as well, and I don't think there's a better time to catch a carp, particularly if the winter's anything like last year. Snow carp, which I've never caught. I've caught an icy carp there, but a snow carp is very high on the agenda. And if you're in the Essex area or you're prepared to travel, and we do get a little bit of the white stuff, that place is a very, very good bet. And I think it'd be a good bet to actually go out with the rivers potentially in some areas, pushing their banks this weekend. A little bit of sort of... It's almost like my guilty pleasure. I don't do it all that often. I just like setting the house up. And it's, for some reason, I love it when I wake up in the morning and there's just frost all in me butt rings.
I like seeing it on the car windscreen when I'm sitting indoors. You've got... I'm a bit of a wimp. But you've got to take into mind that there's loads of other fisheries and loads of other sport to be had. And with, as Dean said, the extra oxygenation, the bream are likely to have a go. Big roach, big perch, don't forget. And wagler and maggot, it's breezy and it's been windy. And don't ignore them. You'll catch on the feeder as well. But waggler maggot, waggler punch bread if it's a bit clear. Terrific methods for this time of year. And because it's so mild, if you're on the bank and there's fish moving, look for fish moving close to the margins. They don't necessarily disappear. Now, you mentioned you like your carp fishing. You've got here your favourite winter carp rig.
Very simple. And this is the one I catch on while I'm over Churchwood during the winter. Because there's a little bit of bait trickling in, quite often single hook baits just on them little spots. And Steve's brilliant. He'll put you on them. Is the best way to go. And generally, small baits, I still like big hooks. I still fish a size 6 with my 12mm pop-ups and my 10mm pop-ups. But
let's look at this bit first, because it's still a sort of a running rig, isn't it? You do the same thing there. You flatten that bit of the swivel so it'll pop out.
You've got a little bit of resistance
semi-fixed.
There. But it turns into, as aside from losing the lead, it turns into a running rig because I'm using tubing.
Tubing there, right, that's pinned down tubing.
Absolutely,
as well, at the bottom. A braided hook length is coated braid, isn't
it? Coated braid, yep.
And then you peeled a bit back with, is that just heavy putty?
I've just got a tiny little shot under there.
Oh, yeah.
And what you do is you put a load of putty around the shot, and then you just strip tiny little bits off until the pop-up slinks ever so slowly, because you can cast this anywhere in the winter. And if you're fanning your rods around, trying to locate them little shoals of fish, and they are quite often in various different venues shoaled up quite tightly. If you can find a fish, then generally there's a couple more bites there. And that one, obviously, as long as you quickly balance it, will cast anywhere and will fish anywhere. It will fish over any detritus, any dead leaves or anything like that. It's just a very good, generic, take-anywhere winter rig that will get you bites.
And little bags, little PVO bags, crumb boilies maybe?
You can put anything you want on it, to be honest with you. Mm. But because it's a very high visual, high-flavoured pop-up, I'd be happy casting that as a single look.
Single, really?
Yeah, I really would.
Oh, that's good stuff. I've got to go back to your Thai exploits.
Oh, that's a shame.
Yeah,
I hate talking about
that. Well, you see, because I think that is a very special fish.
For more ways than one. I've been around the world and filmed with John. That's my cameraman
We
film with online fishing. And I've caught some spectacular fish in Norway, Gran Canaria, Thailand, various different places, and he's filmed me. And bless him, he does it with many, many other people, and he never really gets a chance to fish for himself, even though he's a very keen angler. So one night I said to him, look, you know, get the rods out, finish filming. We'd already had a good day, so we had a couple of decent carp, a couple of decent Mekongs, and he had a 65-70 pound red tail, can't exactly remember the weight, but it was a ginormous one, as you can see, and he had 160 pound arapaima in the space of, well, it took him about 40 minutes to land both of them, but between the bites was an hour, if that. It was ridiculous. So obviously a made up man.
And that's another, that's a very unusual looking fish. It's a bit like an arapaima, isn't it? What is that?
It's an arowana. Oh, now, yeah. there's various different species of them, but the reason that was so special for me is because we went out there to film the big three, the carp and the Mekong, for one show. We dedicated a whole show for the arapaima, but we did a middle show for the sort of slightly smaller and more forgotten species. And when they turn up like that, again, pushing double figures, it's marvellous. And it took me about 4 hours to catch that, but I only had two casts. I made one fluffed up cast, which scared every one of them out of the way because they're surface feeders. Yeah. It took me about 3 hours to spot one more, a pretty much perfect cast on its nose, and it had it straight away. And the fight was unspectacular, came out a couple of times, 30 seconds in the net, and I was just, well, I was lost for words.
Half a minute to go, which is a minute, but only half a minute because you put a lot of words into half a minute. What's coming up next for Dino?
Just chub and barbel fishing, really. I might be getting over to Churchwood for a little bit of carp fishing if the weather's decent. But like I said, -2, it's a good bet all year round. But I've still got, I mean, I know it's a ridiculous size to put with a fish, but I would love to go somewhere near the 8 pound mark for the chub. Oh. And it's a realistic target on the right venues.
Yeah, you fish those little bits of the old Lee, and there are some very, very huge.
Not many bites to be had, but if it goes round, like that big chub that we showed earlier on, it wasn't quite 6 pound, but, you know, it's a fish of a lifetime, and I'm prepared, when the conditions are right, to sit there for, you know, days and days for nothing, with the chance of it going round this winter with just something mind-blowing, and there's nothing that would be more special on this planet than a chub pushing 8 pound.
Well, good luck, mate. If anybody deserves it, you do. And so do I. That's it for today, I'm afraid. Don't forget to follow what's going on here via the website or Twitter, and keep those emails coming in with your young angler photos and any questions you've got too. Dean's been brilliant, mate. Thanks so much for coming.
Thanks,
I really enjoy your company. That's brilliant, mate. Now, to celebrate the festive season, over the next couple of weeks, we've got 2-hour specials in which I'll be guiding you through the best sessions and events we've seen on the show during the year. I promise you, they're definitely not to be missed. The first of them's next Friday at 5 o'clock on Sky Sports 4. That's the first of our 2-hour review shows next week at 5 on Sky Sports 4. But if you want to see it earlier, that show's going to be available on demand in the Sky Sports section of Catch Up from tomorrow. So, have a great Christmas, especially if you manage to get out on the bank for a quick session and tight lines. Now, I've seen you ogling my cake. Do you want a bit?
Absolutely.
I was going to save it and take it home.
I'll have a lot, mate.
This is lovely Lee made this, so you can have a bit of cake here.
Beautiful.
Let's get the knife out.
Watch all 6 Sky Sports channels on your mobile and online.